Thanks, Noam. It's really great to be with you all. I am based in Los Angeles. I'm zooming in from there. And today we'll be discovering and exploring together ethical conduct. And for some of us, that can be maybe a dry subject or a scary one, or maybe one that feels, I know for me, when I was first introduced to this concept of Sila, what it means to have behavior and intentions, to have some ethical kind of background to my actions, some intention. For me, it felt like, wow, I really have to pay attention in terms of like, am I doing the right thing? Not just the wise thing, I wasn't quite there yet. It was kind of like, am I doing what I'm supposed to do? And for me, that felt slightly controlling and not really freeing. So it's kind of like, how can we approach something that may feel like we need to act a certain way? At first, you know, maybe without some kind of examination or wondering like, how can we approach something like this that actually is in accordance with liberation? Like, why are we concerned with ethical conduct? Does it have to be something that feels like I have to act a certain way or be a certain way? And it's actually something that supports our practice, our liberation. And there can be a creative way, a spacious way, more open-ended way of how we create a relationship to each path factor within Sila. So today we're going to be exploring a little bit right speech. And where is there a cultivation of a relationship to right speech that takes into account being imperfect and human? And, you know, life is complicated, right? So what does it mean to have a noble speech throughout our daily lives? How is that possible? Where is it possible? So we'll kind of discuss that and discover the different contours and facets of what that can mean, having kind of a nuanced, multifaceted relationship to right speech a little bit later. But, you know, we'll meditate together for about 30 minutes. I'll give some guidance. And yeah, and we'll have time for introductions. So we'll start with, and I'll give some light guidance for 30 minutes, a few rings of the bell to begin. I invite us all to find a posture, a way of sitting that is well supportive of one's bodily structure. I feel we can sit in such a way that is upright and noble. And perhaps we can have a soft belly, not having to do much. Our bodily presence being more than enough. Allowing perhaps a gentle awareness to start at the top of one's head, like water pouring into a glass. And allowing this kind of soft acknowledgement of one's own bodily presence. Simple and unobstructed. You are here. Allowing this awareness to settle in at the feet. I invite us all to gently gather our attention. Bring some intentional awareness to this bodily process called the breath. Wherever we notice the breath the most in our bodily experience, for some of us, this could be the rise and fall of the belly, or perhaps passage of air at the nostrils, or whatever is true of your experience of the breath, I invite you to place kind of a soft awareness right there on this breath. we may notice that we have an intention to come back to the breath. And of course, there are other experiences happening alongside the breath that may draw our attention away. Every moment of our awareness is a part of our meditation. Each moment is an opportunity to remember, to acknowledge what is true in our experience. This too is happening. This too. And the breath can be a touchstone of experience. Whenever we remember to do so, to touch back in, to acknowledge again. We can give ourselves the space to come back. As often as we can. We may discover that there could be maybe a subtle or not so subtle aggression with our intention to come back to the breath. Maybe a pushing and pulling with where our attention wanders off to. Perhaps there is an opportunity there to expand our understanding and our patience. And to note that this is the experience. It's all part of our practice. And perhaps we can give ourselves a chance to come back to the breath. in these moments, even if we don't feel particularly kind, or our awareness is not necessarily on being kind, I offer you this thought that this very practice is a cultivation of a sort of kindness. We give ourselves the space to plant seeds for this gentle attention, this spaciousness to notice our experience without having to turn it into something else, to have a different mind, a different thought process, a different body. None of those things are necessary. We can begin just where we are and who we are. Perhaps we can give ourselves a break as we come back to the breath. Knowing that this is a practice, there's no special role to fill or some exact measurement we have to meet up with. It's okay. one of my teachers once said, there's no way that you can do this wrong. This meditation practice. One way to hold this kind of instruction of sorts is whatever you're aware of, wherever you end up paying attention to, even if it's not the breath, this too is your practice. This too is meditation. It's all part of our awareness. When we return to the breath, a part of us is teaching ourselves how to gently unhook from any particular preoccupation. And as we sit together, we are also, within our own experience, teaching ourselves perhaps how to hold the breath lightly. The breath does not stay the same. How can we be present with something that changes? That has a life of its own without our making it be. We don't have to consciously create the breath. In this way, our practice is of a mini lab of experimentation, finding out these spaces where we can allow, gently acknowledge, gently be aware, find out where it's possible to hold our intentions with kindness and care. And we find out where maybe we're not quite there yet. That's okay too. Our practice is big enough for all facets of our humanity. The pleasant or unpleasant or neutral experience, it's all allowed. the last few minutes of sitting together, I invite us all to perhaps explore what it could be like to release all effort. Maybe we can find a space where that there's a possibility for gently abiding within the body, not having to push and pull in any one way, giving ourselves this chance to be. Nothing to do, nowhere to go, no one to be. Thank you, everybody, for your practice, your time, and your attention. So it is true that this is a class. And what is also true is that this is a community. So to learn, to receive knowledge, this is not just one way. We're teaching each other. You're teaching me too. In the tradition of the Buddha, practice is done in the context of community. So we're really supporting each other's discovery and learning and awareness. So in that sense, you too have so much to offer. Your voice is valuable. So just want to keep that in mind for a little bit later when discussion opportunities will arise for you. That we're not alone in this practice. We're not alone in our learning. So much of what we often go through in our practice, in our learning, is not unique. Sometimes we share experiences and we don't even know it if we're silent about it. Here is a place where we can support each other. So before I offer some thoughts on right speech and what that means, or the different contours and facets of actually nuanced and multifaceted concept, here's a little opportunity for you to offer your voice. We're just going to do really short introductions. Love to hear your name and what inspires you to be here. That could be, you know, a minute or two at the most, whatever you'd like to offer. So I'll start with myself. Again, my name's Eileen Ybarra. And what inspires me to be here is it's a joy to share the Dharma. It's fun. That's one aspect. It's fun to do. And it's really, in its own way, heartwarming and challenging in a way that feels invigorating, this practice. So I'll leave it there. Please feel free to, well, to go in popcorn style. There's no order. If you'd like to unmute, you are more than welcome to do so. If that feels not right and you'd prefer to chat, you can do that too. But anyone who'd like to go first, please feel free. If you want to unmute, you can kind of raise your hand visually or, you know, or through Zoom, the raise hand function. So yeah. Hi, Tia.
My name is Tia, and I really enjoy here today, and the other times I've managed to make it have been really thought-provoking in a way that I enjoy. So there's in addition to Eileen in particular, listening to the Dharma helps me think about how I'm choosing to do things in a way that I really appreciate. And I've particularly appreciated it.
Thank you. Hi, Angela.
Hi, so I'm Angela. I appreciate the opportunity to deepen my practice and also be part of a community and support others in their practice. So I'm thankful to be here with the group.
Thank you. Hi.
My name's Johnny. I'm in San Francisco, and the title of this piqued my curiosity. And I enjoy hearing the Dharma, and I enjoy hearing the Dharma in community. And I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Yes, my name is Jeffrey. I'm in Bend, Oregon. And I as well, I found, I'm not even sure where I found your topic, but I'm rather new, just a few months into practicing, and I'm just, my monkey brain's trying to grab everything I can and to learn and to practice. So I'm really glad I found this.
Great.
I'll go. I'm Noam, and in addition to having really enjoyed Eileen's other classes, I was also attracted by the title of this class, particularly the curiosity one, and I'm part of it. The whole thing. So I'm curious. I'm here because I'm curious. And I think curiosity is such an important part of practice. So thank you. Glad to be in community.
So there's will be opportunities for sharing voice, sharing your voice, your thoughts through just a meeting or chatting. So So I think now is a good time to kind of delve into this topic of right speech and what that could possibly mean. So I want to read an excerpt from a Tricycle magazine article that I found called Right Speech Reconsidered by Beth Roth. It's from the October 13th, 2017 issue. So I thought that could be a nice beginning, a framing for its exploration today. So I'll start. It says, the Buddha was precise in his description of right speech. He defined it as abstinence from false speech, abstinence from malicious speech, abstinence from harsh speech, and abstinence from idle chatter. In the vernacular, this means not lying, not using speech in ways that create discord among people, not using words that are cynical, hostile, or aggressive in tone, and not engaging in gossip. Reframed in the positive, these guidelines urge us to say only what is true, to speak in ways that promote harmony among people, to use a tone of voice that is pleasing, kind, and gentle, and to speak mindfully in order that our speech is useful and purposeful. So that's a kind of a, I thought, a really nice, short, kind of succinct description, somewhere to start of this concept of this foundational concept of Sila, of kind of our everyday ethical conduct, how we want to be in the world. That's kind of how more I think about it. And also another way is, what is our extension of our practice? So many of us, I include myself in this, come to a Dharma practice. When I say Dharma, the teachings of the Buddha, through the doorway of meditation. I know I was interested in meditation first. I came to classes in person, similar to this, like 18 years ago, from a place of deep depression and anxiety. I heard that meditation was good for those things. So I showed up to a class one day, and I was really surprised to note that I wasn't there to fix myself. I had this kind of unexamined belief that something was deeply wrong with me, and I needed to fix something. And I was shocked to find out my teachers were kind of like, nothing's wrong with you, that you are a person, you're experiencing the full range of the human emotions and the impermanence of life, and that there's some grief along with that. And so many things happen, could potentially happen to us, that can just be hard. So there's so many sorrows in life, and there are joys, and you can be with all of them in a way that is mindful and kind and almost respectful of your own experience. And I was really intrigued, and I found a lot less, I think I have a lot less pressure in my nervous system. I wasn't so wound up, and figuring out what's wrong was like, what if nothing in particular was wrong? You're just a person. And so that was my entryway into so many of the Dharma's lessons. And deeper into kind of Dharma study, and not just the book kind of study, kind of, I think of a study of life, finding out what's in my own experience, learning from just living. The Buddha is really kind of, in my experience, interested in what it means to learn through life. Showing up to classes and being introduced to this concept of how we live is important too. Yes, meditation, and we sit on the cushion. Our mindfulness practice, for instance, actually has something to say to us when we're not meditating, that our lives are actually one practice. We're always practicing something. And one area of practice is our speech, how we communicate with people. So important. Our speech can be this avenue of further freedom, an avenue that brings the cultivation of the spaciousness around difficulty. Our speech can bring us together. We can really kind of obviously communicate what's really going on with us, how we learn from each other, and it can also harm. Such a rich field of practice, of learning, of growth, awareness, and even freedom. And we kind of find out where maybe the heartache is, or the creation of heartache, through our speech. So our speech is so powerful and worthy of our attention, our intention. So I come to classes and hear, you know, similar words and really similar definitions to what I spoke of just a few minutes ago from the excerpt from Beth Roth's article. These very succinct, defined kind of definitions, boundaries, which felt like to me of what right speech is. And so there's this one layer. When I say right, I mean sort of the wise speech, the mindful speech, not so much the perfect speech or the only speech, but just what does it mean to kind of hold our speech in the same way that we hold our meditative practice. You know, when we're on the cushion, wherever we're sitting, standing, however we're meditating, we're closely considering, like today, our practice was focused on the breath, and closely considering something like the breath. This is worthy of our attention and our care. And so our speech, the right speech, I think is just another way of saying this is worthy, our worthy speech, the speech that's intentional and worthy of our care. So on one level, this is, we have to start somewhere, right? Like, what does that mean? It's such a big concept. Well, we start with refraining. Perhaps we can think about what it means to refrain from hurtful speech, intentionally hurtful speech. So much of the Dharma teachings is really coming very close to what do we mean here? What is our intention? Refraining from telling lies, you know? What does it mean to be honest, to be truthful? Giving consideration to having a speech that is focused or more intentioned towards kindness, towards spaciousness. And I like to think of it as also boundaries, where we're respecting people's time and attention. Where we're thinking about how can our speech add to what is a conversation, what is occurring, what are we speaking to, as opposed to maybe not really thinking much of what's coming out of our mouths. I think that's kind of what is pointed to in this value of not participating in idle chatter. I know for some of us, and this was true of me, that speech, right speech, can feel like a directive. Don't do this. Don't do this. So, so much of the Dharma is kind of like, I think of a respect for our lives, our bodies. We're an organic process, right? Not automations. So what can our practice be that is a cultivation of the kind of speech we want to present in the world? What kind of practice do we want? This can be the entryway of curiosity, of inquiry. Where we get very close to our own experience and kind of wondering, what do I want to say? And this doesn't mean necessarily that we have to be, I think of like suspicious speech, or like when I say that, like an intention of like, what am I really saying? Like with every word, there can be some sense of, I know for myself, when I've heard from other people, a sense of like tension, like I got to really be on the ball here. Everything that I say can feel even more closed. So when we notice that, maybe within the body, like I don't quite know how to find the words here. That can often be the case in difficult situations, conversations. This is an opportunity for our curiosity, of quite literally taking a breath. This is where our mindfulness practice can come in everyday situations. Like, okay, there's the tension here. There's, I don't know what to say. This is difficult. And these difficult spaces are opportunities where perhaps we can at least come from an intention of mindful speech, caring, like this is important. How I speak to you is important. what I say that comes out of my mouth, you know, what comes out of my mouth is important. And this conversation is worthy of attention. Our presence can be such a gift where we're really paying attention, giving ourselves this this awareness that this moment, this conversation, this person is important. And that can be, that can feel really palpable, where we're really adding experience that can be rich and varied with our time and our awareness, that respect. Remember, I was teaching last month, and we were talking about right speech. And someone said to me, you know, sometimes when I'm talking and I'm, you know, and I feel very passionate, like I have a lot of feelings about what I say, or sometimes a lot of belief and conviction, and sometimes people get upset with me, or, but I don't want to feel hemmed in, like I can't speak. Like, how can I offer some kind of right speech or some awareness or some care, and where I don't feel like I have to pay attention so closely to everything that comes out of my mouth? It just feels so so restrictive, constrictive. And I think this is another kind of opportunities when we get in those spaces of like, I want to just say what I think. Like, what does that even mean? Like, how can I be in alignment with these aspects of my practice of mindfulness, of care, of paying attention, of not intentionally hurting people with my words? I think one of the most powerful things about right speech is I think there is kind of this imbued kind of sense of intentionality. That we are really encouraged to speak with a sense of purpose. And I think that is, there's this challenge there where we obviously, we can't control everything, right? Sometimes we say something and all of our intentions were there, and maybe the other person reads it differently. Communication is difficult at times. And we don't mean to hurt. And sometimes the impact of our words can be something that we didn't intend, or it's like, oh, that didn't come out right. I wanted to say it a certain way, and the other person is kind of reading or accepting these words in such a way that that was not my intention. And I think this is a powerful opportunity within kind of this realm of practicing right speech, of when we have this kind of care and awareness of our intention, that we are then in a place where we can take some, or we can be accountable for what we say, where we can have kind of the knowledge that we are aware of our words, our intention was there. And then when we are asked, hey, you know, or we are told, you know, that didn't land right for me, or hey, that was hurtful, even if we didn't mean it, this is an opportunity where we can say, really give ourselves this space to really think about it and have a space of maybe apology, or, oh, I hear you, let me rephrase it, or this kind of knowledge that, yeah, that really did happen. As opposed to being in a space of like, well, I didn't say that, or I didn't, what? or things just kind of fly out of our mouths, and then we have no real ownership or accountability or no way to really answer when we're questioned because we weren't very mindful in the first place. So we can be in a space of when we say what we're saying, we mean what we say. And that can be a really powerful asset to any particular relationship that we're in, whether it's a long relationship, you know, our friends, or a relationship that lasts 2 minutes, you know, an interaction at the store. Our presence can be very powerful, and we're giving kind of this a respect to whoever we're communicating, that they're worthy of our time and our attention, including the words that we offer them. So there's this kind of opportunity with practicing speech, and this is a practice. This isn't, we better speak in a certain way or else. It's every moment can be an exploration where we're cultivating this organic process of laying down the seeds of what happens here when I pay attention and consider kind of the roots of what I'm what am I talking about? How can I speak in such a way where I'm heard, where I'm thinking about the other person, where I'm considering my audience? And we can't, this isn't a realm of perfection, right? We can give ourselves a chance to grow, and we respect another person's boundary. Maybe they're somewhere else, you know, their own journey, their own practice, whatever that is. Maybe they've never heard of right speech before in their lives, right? So we meet people where they are and we try our best. So I think this concept of right speech can give us so many different ways of entry points of, I'm curious, where is the lens? Where can we turn kind of our communication in ways that can fit a particular situation and time and to really meet the needs of the moment? So I'm going to use kind of myself here as an example a little bit about what it means to kind of meet the needs of the moment of communication and kind of a fuller understanding of right speech, perhaps. So I'd like to share with you that I'm actually a really introverted person. I'm not much of a talker. And when I was a little bit younger, this often meant not saying much at all. And I'd often find myself in situations, often with people I didn't know very well or people I just met, sometimes friends, but a lot of different social situations, or maybe even social, even at work, you know, different way where my speech was, where there was opportunities to speak. And I just really would think a lot about what was going on, but not share my thoughts. And I noticed over time that there was kind of almost like a frustration with me, kind of a lack of participation, kind of a lack of communication was often seen as not being generous, not giving of my time and my space, of my thoughts, that I really wasn't a part of what was going on. And I thought, wow, you know, sometimes the right speech, eventually as I found this practice, you know, I'd come to classes and think, well, you know, I'm good, you know, I'm nice. I speak to people in a nice way or cool or kind or whatever. Like I was just kind of considered thought nice speech at one level. Oh, well, I'm nice. And then on a deeper level, as I really kind of considered Dharma as like one practice, not just on the cushion, but in every area of my life, I'm not even speaking at all and I'm not contributing to other people's kind of growth. I'm not contributing to my own growth. I'm not saying anything at all. And for me, this kind of omission of speech was not right speech. You got to say something to really kind of be a part of community. And I was really losing out on exchange, on practice and mindful speech and mindful listening. So that's my personality. And others are very different. I like to say that the Dharma, and it's been in my experience too, the Dharma is big enough for all of our experiences of humanity. That includes our personalities, differing personalities. For some of us, our speech can be at times harsh. Maybe we don't mean it to be. Maybe we're just kind of speaking directly and honestly at all times in our way. And perhaps these are opportunities, this concept of right speech, to kind of be curious of like, is this true? Am I just being honest? Is this thought something that needs to be said right now? In this way, is this something that can be hurtful? Is this true? And our mindfulness practice, where we're taking a pause to breathe, perhaps some of us can benefit from taking a pause before we kind of launch into our offering our opinion, right? It's so powerful, right? Speech can be there at any moment. Even the first time something comes out of our mouth and we didn't mean it that way, or we know it didn't land well. Like the breath, we get lost, come back to the breath. Find ourselves speaking, we get lost, we can come back to the moment. And we can begin again and say something else. Perhaps an apology, perhaps, well, let me start again. Let me rephrase. Let me hear you. Maybe we are our speech being so intimately connected to mindful listening. And so this, our speech, there's so many different opportunities for connection, developing really wonderful relationships. You know, our speech connects us and also can be opportunities for hurt, right? So with that hurt, where it's like someone said something to us we didn't like, or we said something that perhaps we didn't mean to hurt somebody, or if we're really honest sometimes, maybe it was on purpose, you know? Sometimes we're not the best in arguments or disagreements. We're only human. Compassion here too. There's no place where compassion doesn't belong, where there is hurt in any context for others and ourselves. This is an opportunity for compassion. It's like, where did the speech go wrong? And sometimes in that space of really recognizing this is not what I intended, or this is not what I wanted to hear, or wow, I really kind of said something that I know was not the best. This is where it's like, okay, this is where it is. This is where the difficulty is. And this is an opportunity for care, for taking a pause, taking a deep breath, being aware. Sometimes I know compassion can be difficult for the self. And we have to start somewhere. This is a practice. This is a lifelong kind of, wherever we are, where we find ourselves in life or whatever situation we find ourselves in, there can be an opportunity for saying, there it is. Okay, I hear that. I hear you. to the other person and to ourselves, I hear you. And to care. Our speech is worthy of our care. I think ultimately, our voices, our opinions, they're important. We have something to add, and conversely, sometimes we have something to detract at times if we're not being mindful, if we're participating in kind of like what I think of as like the big red flag kind of aspects of mindless speech, the opposite of mindful, of as the beginning where I was speaking a little bit to how the Buddha defined very closely what right speech is not, like lying, gossiping, idle chatter, purposely using speech to harm. So I ultimately wanted to offer today, in this exploration of right speech, my hope for all of you and my excitement for you and whatever your Dharma journey is, your meditation journey, perhaps, wherever you are in your practice, that you'll have many meetings or many experiences with this concept of right speech, whether you're in another class or just in everyday life, that there's so many different opportunities to practice, so many different ways to really hold ourselves with kindness and accountability. And there's the curiosity of like, in what way can I say this? In what way can I show up for this moment with the words that I intend to speak? So many different creative ways of showing up, and so many different ways of holding the moment in compassion when things don't go quite right. And beginning again, we don't have to be perfect. Just have to be human, and we can do that, right? So many different ways of being curious, like, what words do I use, you know? Where do I need to be here? What's appropriate? And that is for each of ourselves to discover. It's part of Dharma practice, where we're really kind of, our practice is our lives. So I want to thank all of you for your time and your attention. And I hope this, at the very least, has created some food for thought, some opportunities for inquiry of how right speech does or does not play out in your own lives, and, you know, how you can go forward and discover for your own how to hold this lesson of the Buddha. So thank you. Thank you so much. So we have some time left. I've been talking for a long time. So there's some time if there's any maybe experiences or questions or comments of, you're more than welcome to share in the chat or unmuting. What's right speech for you? So please.
I'll say a couple of things. Thanks, Eileen. That was really, really interesting and thought-provoking. And one thing I'll say is that I've been kind of experimenting with erring on the side of either saying less or saying it more gently, like really scrutinizing, you know, I think I appreciate your caution. Like, it doesn't, you don't want it to be like this stifling thing, but just stopping and thinking, you know, what is my motivation for saying this thing? And I had an incident recently where I needed to respond to an email, and I had two ways to respond to it. And one was a little like, you know, oh, well, you shouldn't have done such and such. And the other was like, oh, well, you know, thanks for letting me know such and such. You know, it was just, and I couldn't convince myself one way or the other. And I thought, well, if you can't convince yourself one way or the other, then why be harsh? You know, let give this person the benefit of the doubt and see, you know, see what it's like to really give them the generous, positive response. So that's one thing I've been thinking about. And then the other is about apologizing and how telling that is. Like, when you see you hurt someone and you have a hard time apologizing, when I see I hurt someone and I have a hard time apologizing, I'm like, whoa, what is that about? Like, what, it just says something about the, you know, the way, I think for me, it's like how myself is all entangled in it, that somehow I have to be right instead of being kind. So those are two things I've been thinking about. And if you have any comments, I'd appreciate them. It's not really a question, but I appreciate your insight. Thank you, Eileen.
Welcome. What you're saying reminds me, brings to mind that, you know, this is the practice, right? Like, this is where we are figuring out what is called for at any given moment or a situation, where we give ourselves that pause, not so much having to scrutinize everything, and how we, as we pause in our meditation practice, we can carry those pauses over to our everyday lives, where we think, okay, how do I respond to this? And so there it is. There's the practice. You know, you're doing it. You're engaging in consideration and curiosity of like, well, if I can't, you know, is this really the way to go? If I can't convince myself of this, why do I need to say it? Like, these questions, you know, that's so huge. And what you are saying about apology reminds me a lot about how we, our identities can get really fused with our thoughts, or our thoughts, and then we choose to open that, to air them out. And that is a rich field of discovery. Then we can kind of really discover these spaces of where we're tied, you know, in the grip, or really enmeshed our identities into what we think. And then we find out for ourselves, you know, that is a difficult place to be. As then, you know, it's like, we know we've hurt somebody maybe in those situations where we're like, we notice we're really tied up into our views, and then not wanting to apologize for that hurt, that impact. That's really wise to be like, wow, what is that about? Then when we are aware of like, what is that about, where we can have that curiosity and think, that is a wonderful opportunity. It's like, oh, this is where I'm caught. This is where I want to be right. What is that about? And so that is a wonderful place to start. And maybe when we ask the question, that's then we can begin to find out, like, where are we coming from? Where is there some suffering here that doesn't need to be here? So all, you know, then it's more discovery, more inquiry. We give ourselves that space to even have some compassion, right? You know, to like, we're just people. So like, oh, what is that about? That can be very powerful. Thank you for sharing. So I see some in the chat. Thank you very much for this. The compassion and curiosity provide a much more gentle approach to right speech. Thank you. Thank you for speaking and adding to chat. Yeah, I mean, we can be so hard on ourselves, so many of us. And I also think this kind of approach I have found in my mind, I think is more realistic. life is really, it's a cliche, life is complicated. There's so many gray areas. I think I've found sometimes, and some of us can find this concept of right speech can be in our minds, kind of a strict binary of it's this or that, it's this way or that way. And if we're not this way, then it's all over. And it's like, well, life is complicated. There are lots of ins and outs. We're all in a, I like to think of this, we're all in, you know, who we are as human beings, we're a natural process. We grow and are cultivated and nourished in all different types of ways. And so our speech comes out of a natural process. So, you know, give ourselves some room to grow. Thank you. Hi, Angela.
Thank you for your wise and kind words. I find it's so hard with right speech to find the right words. And I think what I find happens is in conversation, things go so fast. Somebody says something, we respond I respond immediately. And to respond that fast, I think I'm an autopilot most of the time. I'm not paying attention or paying close enough attention. And then, and also it's a practice. I think I'm beginning to learn paying attention, to be intentional, to understand who is it serving, that kind of thing. But I've also learned, I have a grandson who's about, who's 1 year and 3 months old. And when you ask him a question, I've been told you have to wait for 10 seconds for his response. So I'm thinking, maybe I should apply that to everything. Take 10 seconds. It feels like a really long time. Like you ask him something and he knows, but we expect like he just will say it immediately. And I've been told, no, with children, you have to wait 10 seconds for them to formulate a response. I'm like, maybe I need to give myself 10 seconds when I respond, and maybe I need to keep spaces open in conversations for responses, for that thought to happen. My experience to offer.
That's wonderful. Yeah. It's so amazing where our teachers show up. You know, our teachers can be a toddler, you know, our loved ones. And we're there, and we're attentive and mindful of our lives. We find our teachers in sometimes the most unlikeliest places. So that pause, that's wonderful. Yeah, that's a wonderful place to start. He can give himself 10 seconds. Maybe, you know, I can give myself 10 seconds. That's great. Thank you.
Hi, I don't know how to raise my hand. I keep looking for it. This is Shelley, and I just really, really appreciate your perspective and your approach of curiosity. I really struggle with the word right, mm-hmm. as I was telling Noam before we started. I did not like the word right. And that actually, it's such a general approach to just be curious about it and to not approach it as I have to fix myself and I have to do everything perfectly, exactly perfectly right now. Otherwise I'm a terrible human being and I'm accumulating tons of horrible karma and, you know, to not put all of that on myself. And what I was thinking about when I was listening to you talk was, I remember going to a teaching a number of years ago, on the six paramitas. Mm-hmm. And I remember every single one came back to patience. every single paramita was related to patience. And when I was listening to you talk, I was like, wow, where's my patience practice? Like I was, and I remember being at that retreat and going, God, I just really don't have patience. Like I haven't, I don't know what that is. I don't know how to cultivate it. And I contemplated it for a short time afterwards, and then I forgot about it for all this time. So where is my patience practice? My patience in, you know, during meditation and outside of meditation. And I think curiosity might be part of cultivating patience. Mm-hmm. Because it's non-judgmental. It's just right. noticing. And I think in awareness is where like things can shift. Not in making myself be different. And I also was thinking, you know, about what is patience. And I was thinking, I think like the first thing is the pause.
Yeah.
Just pause and get out of it and just notice and like come back to like my practice and reorient myself in relation to the teachings and just notice what's happening. So this has been so wonderful for me. I really, this is the most wonderful teaching on this practice that I've had. So I really appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome. Be happy to hear that. Thank you for sharing. So it's exactly 11:30 on my clock. And I want to respect everybody's time. So thank you again so much for your practice, your attention, you showing up for yourselves and showing up for community by being here. And I will be here on Zoom again next week. We're discussing a different aspect of Sila. So it's a three-part series. Today was right speech. Next week will be right action. And then the last will be right livelihood. So we'll discover together. And there's a little note in chat on Donna. I want to pay attention to that. And is there anything else, Noam?
Oh, just so many thanks, Eileen. I think it's been expressed by others, so I won't go on and on, but I've really enjoyed this myself, and I see everyone else has, and I appreciate you. And just to be super clear, at the San Francisco Dharma Collective, we always, your participation in the Dharma is a form of dana. And if you can also donate, that helps us tremendously, cover our expenses, and of course support our teachers. If you are not already part of our mailing list organization, please check out our website. We have lots of classes every week, including peer groups and teacher-led, and teachers from many different traditions teach at the San Francisco Dharma Collective. So check it out. But thank you, Eileen.
You're welcome.
This week. Hopefully everyone else will be too, and tell your friends if they're not here. Bring them back, and have a good day, everyone.
Have a good day.